everybody for being here. Today I'm going to be concentrating on cancer with liver metastasis, which is what the entire topic evolves around. I'm a medical oncologist. I'm going to talk about chemotherapy and these type of cancers with metastatic disease to the liver. So this is very complex. It's a multidisciplinary approach. We can't do this thing by ourselves. There has to be a team. Has to be a group of people taking care of the patients in order to come up with a very successful outcome, because there's no one way of doing this. And as Dr. Wolfowitz was saying, this is, every patient is different, every approach is different, different scenarios on the same situation. So just briefly, cancer progression, it was mentioned before, but this is a cartoon just to make it a little bit more graphic. So when we talk about liver cancer, colon cancer with liver metastasis, we're talking about stage four colon cancer, which is this stage, that the cancer already grew in the colon someplace, or the rectum, and it went to another organ, in this case the liver, or other places. So it's more advanced disease. So this is about the genetics we're talking about. This is specific for colon cancer, and this is a question that comes around all the time, that's why I put the slide here. Why do we have cancer? Why do we have colon cancer? Why do people develop colon cancer? Well, 75% of the colon cancers are sporadic, meaning that there's no genetic family history or anything else. They happen because they happen, and they happen according to certain risk factors, obesity, diet, different, lack of exercise, things like that, that can predispose to cancer, but they're not the etiology of the cancer. They don't cause the cancer by themselves. They predispose, they're risk factors. Now, that's 75% of the cancers. The rest, the other 25, could be familial, which is, there's a family history, but there's no genetic, there's no specific genetic marker that we can follow in that family. And there's a 2-5%, maybe a little bit more, of other known genetic cancers, like Lynch syndrome. We haven't mentioned this. I'm not going to get into Lynch syndrome, but it's a known type of cancer that happens. It's a cluster of cancers that happen according to different mutations in certain people. But, and these are the mutations, but that's a minority of the cancers. Most of the cancers are either familial. We don't know. There's a family history, but we don't know why the cancer is happening. We don't know what the genetic problem is. Or sporadic. So this is an overview just to clarify what are we talking about. So colon cancer, we call it colorectal because colon and rectum is the same organ. The difference is anatomical, and Dr. Fioretti will talk about that. We approach it differently because of the anatomic situation of the rectum as compared to the colon, but the cancer is the same. It's called colorectal cancer. Metastatic is curable in some patients, as we mentioned, as we have an example here. So, there's people that get cured from colon or rectal cancer metastasized to the liver or other organs. And that's something that may not happen in other cancers, but in colon cancer is well known, and it's getting better and better. For the purpose of curing someone, we have to have a complete surgical resection. That's the standard of care. And Dr. Cohn will keep talking about different things. We talk about yttrium. But the surgical, complete surgical resection still is the standard of care for curing patients with metastatic colon cancer. The idea is performed with curative intent. That is, the resection has to be complete. All the cancer has to come out. R0 is a term that we use, meaning that cancer is out. There's no residual disease microscopically. You take the cancer out, there's clear margins, there's no cancer anywhere. Of all the liver metastasis is a standard treatment. Now, liver-directed therapies, as we're going to be talking about, or ablative therapies, radio frequency ablation, cryoablation, radioembolization, chemoembolization, there are many of those. Even radiation therapy to the liver, in combination with definite surgery, are used all the time. Why? They are an adjunct to surgery, and they improve survival, and they improve the care of these patients. Systemic chemotherapy, which is what I do, is not curative in itself, but it helps a lot. Systemic chemotherapy shrinks things down, makes the surgery easier, and prolongs survival, and kill micrometastasis. We're going to see that. So, the definite treatment, so what is the definition of treatment with curative intent that we mentioned before? Well, it's a treatment applied to those patients with a realistic chance of cure. You have to be sure that the patient is resectable. Or if it is not resectable, borderline or unresectable, you have to shrink it down to make it resectable so the patient can get cured. Patients with unresectable disease without resection potential are not considered with a realistic chance of cure. So some patients, unfortunately, they're not be able to be resected. And in that case, you can't take all the cancer out. So you have to do palliation therapies. And in that case, different things come into play. So this is just terms, but I put it down there because every patient is different. So it's not the same to have synchronous, let me see if I can, there you go. Synchronous liver metastases. That means that the primary colon or rectal cancer are in place and the patient has simultaneous metastases at the same time, that's synchronous, or metachronous, meaning that the colon cancer or the rectal cancer was taken out years ago, or a year ago, or 6 months ago, or 2 years ago, and then the cancer came back into the liver. So the approach to that is different. One thing is to have two cancers at the same time you have to take out. The other thing is just to have only one side of the disease that you have to take out. And you can imagine that's different. Removal of all cancer is necessary for a cure. Obviously, you have to take it all out. Here is the accepted standard of practice of care is resection ablation of the liver metastases. And this is because of a substantial cure rate. We know that a lot of significant amount of people get cured. You take the cancer out from the liver, although it's metastatic and it's spread, and people survive and are cured. So how do we define resectable? How do we say, well, this patient we can take all the cancer out, this patient we cannot? And it's a multidisciplinary situation. You have to look at how the cancer is involved in the liver, how much of the liver you're gonna leave behind after the surgery so the patient can survive, and if everything is adequate for the liver to survive as well. You have a good outflow, an adequate liver remnants, or an adequate inflow of blood and biliary drainage in order to keep things functioning. Okay, so this is first-line chemotherapy for metastatic colorectal cancer given with curative intent. We mentioned that before. Well, this is based on one trial that was published a while ago. But you can see that if you go through the topics, some patients achieve complete clinical response. In this case, from 1,500 patients, 62 had complete response, but 52 of them progressed, and 10 of them survive after all. So meaning that with chemotherapy alone with chemotherapy, in patients who have metastatic disease, the cure rate is very small. That's what we need, chemotherapy as part of a complete or comprehensive treatment to take care of these patients who are, you know, having disease in the liver. So as a cartoon, just to put in the graphic, we have liver metastases. How do we integrate chemotherapy and liver surgery for metastatic colorectal cancer? So if you're non-resectable, you're going to try to shrink that tumor down and try to make it resectable as much as possible to offer the possibility of taking all the disease out. And if it is resectable, you try to use chemotherapy before or after surgery. Either way, before, after alone, depends on the patient, depends on how we plan it at that point for that particular patient, because there's benefit on doing that. And the survival benefit is clear and has been shown in many trials. So when I say adjuvant therapy that we mentioned before, what is adjuvant therapy? Well, adjuvant therapy is a chemotherapy given after a resection to eradicate the micrometastasis. So we take the cancer out from the liver, there's no disease anywhere else, but we give chemotherapy afterwards. Why? Because even though you don't see cancer anymore, there might be some cells floating around that you want to kill for them not to come back. And we know that patients relapse in that way. You take everything out, you take the colon cancer out, and 2 years later you see cancer in the liver. Why that happens? Because the cells from the colon migrated to the liver before we take them out, before the surgery, and they grew in that place for a little while, and then they come back. So by giving chemotherapy to patients, we try to prevent that. We try to kill those little cells that are floating and that will not come back if we kill them on time. The same thing with neoadjuvant. Neoadjuvant is the chemotherapy done prior to the surgery with the same purpose. You try to shrink the tumors down, you try to make them more resectable, and you try to kill the micrometastases. So when you take the cancer out, then the cancer will not come back. Conversion therapy is another term that means that when you have a cancer that's unresectable or borderline resectable, the surgeon says, I don't know if I can take all this out because it's complicated, it's involving this and this and that. We give chemotherapy, the cancer shrinks, and then it's easy to take out, and the cure rates improve. Okay, I'm going to finish with this. This is just one trial. There are tons of trials done out there about metastatic colon cancer and rectal cancer and liver metastases. This is one of the famous ones because this trial was done in Europe, in the UK, and it's been going on for many years. And it shows that by using chemotherapy pre and post surgery, things are much better. So this is a schema. So here you have, it's very simple. People went, this is two arms. One group has surgery alone. The other group has chemotherapy, which is called FOLFOX, surgery, and then chemotherapy again. And all the patients that were eligible were patients with liver metastases. And this is the amount of patients they enrolled. It was 182, 152 got resected. Here, 152 got resected after preoperative chemotherapy, and then they received postoperative chemotherapy. So it was pretty good. Patients who got chemotherapy prior to the surgery, 78% of the patients could do that. There was no unexpected toxicity from chemotherapy. The post-op chemotherapy was not as good because patients have to recover from surgery, they're not in shape, there are many other problems happening. So only 44% of the patients received all the chemotherapy after the surgery. And you can see here that, you know, most of the people with the pre-op chemotherapy got some response to treatment. Complete response when the cancer is not seen anymore, only 4%. But many people got partial responses, 40%, which is pretty significant. Some people got stable disease, and only 7% of the people or 6% of the people progress. So it's safe to do that. The thing is, you can do chemotherapy prior to surgery, not wasting time. And you're actually improving things out. This is a progression-free survival. It means that people that survive without progression of disease after this approach, and it's 8.1% at 3 years. So basically, to give chemotherapy prior to surgery, it works. In certain patients, some patients we don't do that. Some patients will go ahead and do the surgery first because it makes sense in that particular situation. Not all the patients are the same, but patients with multiple liver metastases and patients who you think that they may have a lot of burden of disease, it's a good approach to do this. And we use it all the time. The overall survival wasn't that good, was a little bit less, but still a positive result, although non-significant. There were not more cancer deaths on the patients, or overall deaths on the patients without chemotherapy. That means that the treatment is safe. So what is the conclusion of this? I'm going to stop here because it's going to get too long. But so perioperative chemotherapy with FOLFOX in this case, but we use other combinations as well, improves progression-free survival, but the trial failed to demonstrate an overall survival because it was not powered to do that. So essentially what I tried to show here, just in one trial, but there are many, many, and we can spend hours talking about this. So what are the take-home points? Colorectal cancer metastatic to liver is curable after complete resection with curative intent. In some patients with resectable or converted to resectable disease, that's a very good thing. It doesn't happen in all cancers, but in this cancers it does, and there's a lot of proof of that. Chemotherapy associated with improved progression-free survival we use prior and after definite surgery. So we know chemotherapy for this type of cancers work, and it's indicated, and we use it as a routine treatment. And the last point was related to the trial I'm not going to discuss, but essentially, sometimes you have more response rate to chemotherapy, but then what is that related to survival is not known yet.